soul sitting here. It's indeed a great moment for me to talk about this art form, Vilasini Natyam. During the process of deciding different subjects for my graduation, so during the process of deciding which subject I should take in my graduation, I was meeting various experts. And in one such conversation, I was passionately talking about classical dance and my commitment to it, what I feel about it. And this lady said that classical dance music, they come later in society. As a society, we need to first focus on the basics of life: food, shelter, clothing, employment. Classical dance music, later. So at that impressionable stage of my life, I was a little taken aback. And I went back to my mother, my first guru in Bharatanatyam, Kamalini Dutt, in a very disoriented state. And I asked her, am I doing something elitist? When majority of my society is struggling with basics, am I doing something which will remove me from the reality? And she said that music and dance, they are basic needs of life. Classical music and dance take us back to our roots, take us back to who we are, tell us from where we are coming. And talking about economics, a woman from a poor background, she also gets up in the morning. She cleans the front area of her house, makes a pattern in the morning, a pattern which will not even last for a day. That is her self-expression. And self-expression is basic. So she told me, if you choose to perform a classical dance form, you will not only addressing your own artistic, spiritual, aesthetic needs, but also of those who watch you. Because we are not just human beings, we are spiritual beings. And here I am, after 2 decades, standing in front of you as a practitioner of 2 Devadasi dance forms, Bharatanatyam and Vilasini Natyam. Vilasini Natyam is a lesser known art form. As she said, it was revived in 1990s, learned, researched by a very well-known name in the dance field, Swapna Sundari. And this art form had to be renamed as Vilasini Natyam. Now, in today's society, where needs and wants and desires are often enmeshed, where most of us are driven by speed, market forces, where somebody else mostly tells us, decides for us what we need in life, who we need to be, where there's a constant pressure of proving oneself according to how the others want to see us, a society in which censorship, age appropriateness, they're acquiring new meanings every day. In a society in which religion and spirituality are mostly misinterpreted, in such a society, Devadasi art forms, which require us to look deep within ourselves, such art forms which belong to a different era, yet are contemporary. Such art forms may seem like belonging to a time warp. Now, some people say that these art forms are esoteric, elitist, even erotic. Some people say that Devadasis and prostitutes are same. Some people say that people from a higher caste have actually appropriated the art of Devadasis, and they raise a question mark on the ownership. Now, all these notions, they create a lot of misconceptions about the artist and about the art. And I want to address some of them today. Now, I believe as an artist that whatever is in the manifest form is coming from a very deep-rooted thought, which is also stemming from a need. So the need to connect to God, or call it by any name, higher consciousness, the need to connect to that power through music and dance, the need to go deep within a piece of literature and bring out the hidden meanings, the need to connect large sections of society through dance and music. Such needs of a collective consciousness, they created this patra, this character called Devadas. In the temple, she was, of course, wedded to the deity, and that's why she was known as Nitya Sumangali. Nitya means eternal. Sumangali means auspicious. So from morning, when she woke up the Lord through dance and song, till night, when she again put him back to sleep, she was performing various dance rituals. Rituals which not only connected her to the Lord as a wife, as a friend, as a confidant, as a bhakta, but also she was the link between the God and the devotees. In the royal court, she took a piece of literature which had a scope for elaborate exposition, because the sadhas, the royal court, was comprised of the king and intellectuals, various artists, politicians. So there, the audience obviously was of such a high intellect. So there was the need to understand the literature in a very, very colorful and artistic way. So she was entertaining them, but in an aesthetic manner, thereby going deep into the meanings of literature through music and dance. And she did the same in a closed chamber, a chamber comprising of, again, the intellectuals, but the proximity between the audience and the artist was very less. So she sat and she elaborated on a piece of literature for hours, thereby building different narratives, going back and forth in time, playing different characters. So she was opening up the mindscapes of people. And not only love songs, but also texts which were heavy in spiritual content. And for the general audience, for the general public, which did not have access to knowledge, she was like a teacher. She took the essence of various shastras, epics, mythologies, and she wove the stories through dance and music in a theatrical format. So what was the purpose there? The purpose was to educate the people in a very colloquial way. So she played a character, be it Satyabhama in Bhama Kalapam, where she is the wife of Krishna, and she explores various shades of love. You know, a love which is of a spiritual quality. Be it Golabhama, where she plays the role of a maiden. Maiden is a very ordinary person in the society, but she engages with a priest on topics which are very relevant to society. Birth, death, reincarnation, stages of life. So through such narratives, she was engaged in infotainment, if I can use the word. Informing people, entertaining them, and educating them. Now to do all this, she was not just moving her limbs. She was trained in a very systematic manner from a young age in many subjects. Music, dance, literature, mythology, rhythmology, ethics, aesthetics, scriptures, sutras, shastras. And with this collective knowledge of so many subjects, she brought the essence of a literature through her body. Now, such a beautiful artist, such a vibrant art form, how did it die out in time and how it had to be brought back? Because the art was exquisite, but the system of Devadasi had flaws. See, she was married to the deity, all right, but she's a human being. And she is not allowed to marry in a conventional way, although the priest in the temple can marry. So she can take a patron. She has children with those patron, with that patron, but the children do not get the name of the father. Now that creates cracks in the system. And these cracks, they kind of widened up over a period of time. And with coming in of Britishers, their own set of moralities, the entire system was really breaking down. And again, there was the social need to abolish the system. But what was sad is that the temples and the priests, their lives didn't get affected. The zamindari system, the royalty, those families, they kind of readapted themselves to a modern society with the resources that they had. And public finds its own ways of entertainment, good, bad or ugly, doesn't matter. So who has affected these artists, these women artists? And what was painful in the Telugu land is that their own children, they did not want to associate with the dance form. They told their mothers, we don't want you to ever dance. Take a vow on your dancing belts that you will not dance. You will not teach. Such a resistance from the society and from within. But still, there were artists like Madhula Lakshmi Narayana, my guru's guru. They went to the government, fought for their rights, and took permission to perform at least once or twice in a year. So some of these ladies who did not have that strength, who had to survive somehow, of course, they did all kinds of menial jobs to survive. Some of them did take to prostitution, but not all of them. So we need to understand that Devadasi is not a synonym for prostitution. We need to understand from their point of view what they went through. And what is most important is, how did their art survive? It's because of those few ladies who believed in their conviction for the art form and had this ray of hope that someday it will come into the limelight again. Now, that someday came when Swapna Sundari saw them in Yeluru, and she was mesmerized by these ladies who were performing sitting. And she said, I have to learn this art form. Initially, there was a no. They said, no, hum nahi sikhayenge. But seeing Swapna Sundari ji's conviction, her commitment, her passion for their art, they said, fine. And they taught this art unconditionally, no questions asked, completely like a service. A service to the art. And Swapna Sundari, she learnt it with complete devotion. Now, she is a very well-known name in Bharatanatyam and Kuchipudi. But she had to learn this art from the scratch. Because this art is not a sister art form of Kuchipudi. It's not a derivative of Bharatanatyam. It's a distinct dance language of Telugu Kalavantulu. Kalavati is how they were known as. So this art for me has broken many bubbles of what art is, how it connects to society, what is the relevance of art even today, who is a true artist, what is the purpose of an artist. And I'm also a part of the society. I also kind of get driven by all these external forces. But when my bubbles of fear and doubts and disbelief, when they surround me, the art comes back and pokes all these bubbles and puts me back on my path of self-exploration. So I wish to share with you a small piece. It's Bruhi Mukundeti, a bhajan, which was performed by Madhula Lakshmi Narayana in the temple. It was a part of a daily ritual.
Rasane pahimukundeti. Thank you.